of Harvard. It's windy, but it's in and out of the wind. The crew's doing great.
We were fortunate to have a weather window on Mount Harvard, but that's not always the case.
Corey?
Tomer, how are we doing?
Good, dude. You?
I'm doing really well.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful day.
Yeah.
Sun's shining.
Yeah, it's great to see the sun, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's Tori Udall basking in the sunshine.
Probably just the, that challenge of just, you know, trying to make that winter 14 summer.
Anna Marie Meagle is right. That's what pulls us out of a warm bed in the middle of the night. But there are plenty of days with no weather window, and you still need to stay in shape.
Yeah, it's a great training tool, because another thing is, like, on a day like today, the winds are blowing, it's really brutal, and instead of being up on a peak battling the elements and being worried about avalanche danger and things like that, we could be on the ski resort, and it's a safe haven.
It's about making lemonade out of lemons. This training session was at Copper Mountain. The wind had the weather station at the top spinning fast.
So after you get to the top, you got to take your skins off, which are these sticky things. They're kind of a two-way material where if you go uphill, they kind of hold their grip.
The consistent training gives you flexibility. A good example are long days like this heading up to Capitol Peak.
All right, so we just skinned up here to just about K2, and there's John down there. And there it is,
Capitol Peak and the knife edge, and it is wind blown and it's dangerous.
That trip up to Capitol ended at K2. We didn't like conditions. We'd have to wait for the next weather window, and in the meantime, continue making lemonade from lemons.
Thanks a lot for coming out. And yeah, I'm going to kind of turn this into more like my virtual classroom. I do teach two courses at Colorado Mountain College. I teach a weather and climate course, which actually is offered in the spring semester. Right now I'm in a physical geography course and an environmental science course. So actually a couple of the things that we'll do tonight, short sort of small brainstorming pieces, are pulled from a couple of the courses that I've done in the past. But that being said, it's a small intimate group tonight, so we can make it interactive at any time during the presentation. You want to make a comment or a question about something that you're seeing up here, I'm happy to sort of open it up and I can chat about it with you. So just raise your hand like we're in a classroom and we'll go from there. So she talked about the books. I'm really excited about this book. It came out last year, and now that we have all this snow, it'll be really useful this winter, hopefully. So again, get your copy of that if you'd like. And the Colorado Mountain Club Press printed 3,000 copies last December. The last about 10 copies that I know of that exist are sitting over here because they released a second printing on December 1st. So it's pretty awesome that it was able to sell that many. I was surprised. But, with all the skiing community being so great and bustling in Colorado, it's a really neat thing to see. This was my original book, the Colorado 14er High Bivvies. So I'll kind of open up the show with this, sort of talking about how sleeping on the summits is kind of how I eventually got to where I am now in the last about 7 or 8 years. I did this project that was kind of wacky. I was up on Mount Elbert and it was blowing 50 miles an hour, and I was getting ready to go over to Alaska for an expedition on Denali. And my friend Chris, who you saw in the opening video, says to me, man, are you sure that like you want to go to Denali? It's going to probably be every bit as windy as this, you know? And our head was sort of in a fog that day. It was sort of, high altitude and a headache from all that and everything. And then that's when the idea came about. I said, well, shoot, we're sleeping up on this summit. I could probably put a tent on every single 14er summit. And he said, man, that's crazy. Why would you want to do such a thing? I said, well, I don't know. Like sometimes in life we set goals, right? And, you know, it'd be kind of cool to experience that, you know, the sunrises, the sunsets, the stars at night. And so we set out on this project where we used our education in weather and climate and to learn more about Colorado's challenging weather, but also to sort of think outside the box to problem solve. And that's what sleeping on the summits was for me. And to get to see views like this, like up on Long's Peak, for example, all the way out onto the eastern plains of Colorado, for example, or up on the Maroon Bells, getting that tent up on these two iconic peaks outside of Aspen, and just the views and the solitude that you get from that, and then catching the sunrises. And then we all learn lessons in life from failure, you know, and there were so many times on this project that I turned around. And nevertheless, on every project that I've done, I've sort of, you know, maybe at times felt like I failed, but the things that I learned from those experiences really at times maybe didn't make it feel like a failure and stuff. And so that's what these projects are all about. And my first attempts at forecasting weather too. you know, we're out there and here's me sighting it in, like, oh yeah, the storm's coming. I think, you know, it's going to hit us, right? And Chris is standing behind me with, even back at the time, this was in 2011, but even at the time, our phones were getting better to where we could pull up some radar a little bit on the phone. And now we have better cell coverage on the 14er. So I'm using these different radar apps all the time. But this was my radar app back then, was using my hand. But in this presentation tonight, we'll get into more of stuff with the winter and everything and predicting the weather and the forecasts. Just some more shots from some of these summit camps. And this was an experience that I'll never forget. And that sort of led me into wanting to learn more about Colorado's challenging weather in all seasons and everything. And so this was up before I went to Everest for the first time. I went up to Mount Elbert and spent the night up on the summit and actually learned that it's probably better and safer to go in March or April or May and sleep on a summit because there's no thunderstorms. It's a lot colder, and that'll also train me for, you know, say chopping out a tent platform in the snow and everything. But it was, you know, look at how gorgeous it is too with the different colors we get in the winter with the alpenglow and the sunrises and the sunsets. And that of course led me to my first summit of Everest. I was really fortunate to go back again in 2015 to Everest. There was an earthquake at that time. And then earlier this year, I went back again, but I got to climb from Tibet. So at the end of the show, I'll finish the show with discussing a little bit about what it was like to attempt climbing without supplemental oxygen, which is the first time I went with oxygen. So again, all my projects in the mountains, whether it's climbing, skiing, hiking, and you might attest to this in your own personal journeys, it's a progression, right? It's learning more about yourself through these experiences and then sort of raising the bar with what you're doing. And that's what I do to encourage other people around me too. But you got to start from scratch, and pre-trip planning on trips is really important. And this is what I carry in my pack. Maybe if you look at this real quick, you might be similar. So in the winter, we've got more winter gear, obviously skis, our ultralight setups with AT boots and bindings. All AT means is all terrain. We have Dynafit bindings with the smaller pins that are a little bit different than our resort binding. Our skis are a little bit lighter weight with smaller underfoot. Raise your hand if you're a skier. So yeah, maybe I'm kind of speaking your language if you're a skier and we ski in the resort. I ski in the resort too most of the time because then that's the best way to stay trained like you saw in the video and avoid avalanches and things like that. But all these things are important. And then here's the basic essentials. A lot of these are sort of in line with the 10 essentials. So it doesn't matter what season you're in, whether you're in the summer, the winter, carrying these in your pack can save your life, really, if you get into bind or even just having them for comfort in the outdoors. And then I love doing hut trips. In fact, next week I'm gonna get out on a hut trip with some friends and may not carry a stove because we're staying in a hut. We'll definitely carry the beer and wine and maybe a deck of cards. They've got games in some of these beautiful huts. Has anyone been on a hut trip here? So yeah, there's about 100 huts in Colorado ranging from the Front Range across to the 10-mile Mosquito here into the backcountry, the Jackal Hut, the Fowler-Hilliard Hut. There's a lot of other huts near Leadville and stuff, and then ranging over to Aspen. So there's so many huts to go out and explore, and that's what I love the most, I think, about getting to backcountry ski, is you get fresh tracks no matter what. And so, yeah, starting with the basics. If you're gonna go on a trip outside, what should you consider? And if for those of you who have tried a hut trip, and it seems like we've got a pretty experienced crew here, so if you want to research an area, the internet's been great these days, right? I'm going to advocate again for getting my guidebook because the internet's too easy, right? But, you know, go with friends. I know a lot of us probably have been introduced to the outdoors and through friends, family, people that take you to those places first. That's the best way, in my opinion, to stay safe and be safe and learn the craft and making good decisions about terrain. So even knowing the difference between hiking or skinning up a slope versus having to climb a steep couloir is gonna play into that as well. And then my favorite is being open to learning more. So you're exploring your climbing and skiing with what I say is better, going with somebody that's better than you. Maybe they're a stronger fitness-wise, so it'll motivate you to train harder, or maybe they are better at reading maps. They can teach you something about that with compass and navigation, or just going to an area. If you've never been there, you've got somebody that's been there, that's the best way to do it. Plus they can break trail, right? That's the best. And then weather is key. And that's what our focus is gonna be tonight, is weather being the most important factor. Starting early on a trip is great too, because if you start early, you have plenty of time, you don't have to rush. We'll get more into that when it comes to thinking about the four factors of avoiding an avalanche, and we'll brainstorm some of that in just a bit. So looking at a basic weather map is the key, right? Let's say I wanted to go on a trip this Saturday to a hut that was 15 miles in somewhere. It was like the Betty Bear Hut's pretty far in there. And I saw this weather map, and this is just a general assessment. Of course, we can get lots of forecasts even from our apps on our phone. We can go to the NOAA website is a really good one, the pinpoint forecast. There's lots of ways to gather information, but a general overview is the most important. If I'm planning a hut trip for this weekend and I saw this on a forecast, a cold front coming, what sort of things might you think about if you saw that and you're planning a trip? Well, first of all, you'd say, well, there's a cold front coming. Maybe there's snow associated with that, so I've already got to be on alert. Versus if you had a different sort of map that showed no cold front and just high pressure moving in, which high means dry and good weather, then you say, oh, well, the weather's going to be good. So you already have to put your guard up if weather's coming in, and then you have to delve deeper. So a lot of ways to do that is you look at the big picture, and then these sites, the NOAA.gov website and the Colorado Avalanche Information Center websites, are the two places I go because they'll give me the best information on at least what's out there currently. And then it's more about going and diagnosing the weather in the field and then assessing avalanche conditions too. And so tonight's presentation will sort of delve into all these items, but these are important pieces of information. And then defining the season, right? You're about to pack your pack. We all know it's December. It's so cold. This morning was pretty freezing. So I'm packing my gear. I'm getting lots of extra down jacket stuff in there, booties, mittens, things like that. Stuff that I wouldn't need in the summer when I'm hiking, of course. Here's just a little consideration of temperature. So you're defining the season, and that's going to help you assess weather and just current conditions. And these are typical temps higher up at 13,000 feet. So we're seeing that once we drop into these months right now, we're in the cold category. So we're packing lots of winter gear. Another thing to consider with winter weather is that storms develop much slower, but they also linger for much longer. So, you know, that's why we've gotten snow the last couple of days, is that this sort of system that's training in from the Pacific Ocean, which sort of can be termed Pineapple Express, is taking a long time to push out. And we've got snow each day. We're going to get some more snow tonight. Maybe it's only a couple of inches. But that's much different than the summer or the fall when we get frontal precipitation more than we get sort of these systems that stick around. We do get fronts now too, but the systems stick around. And so that's something to understand about the winter, is that a forecast can show you it's going to be stormy and it's just going to stay that way. Or if you get a bluebird day, then you're very fortunate, of course. But the wind is what is also really, really important and to understand and see. And again, these are wind speeds at 13,000 feet. And I've divided sort of the six warm months by the six cold months. And what do you notice about the cold months? Yeah. And again, this is, you know, most of us aren't going to be going up to 13,000 feet, but it's also something to consider. Even today, did anybody ski Vail at all? I was up there this morning. What was it like up above Chair 9 or on the top of the mountain?
Went out this afternoon. It was beautiful.
Yeah, but it was a little bit windy.
It was really still.
Yeah. Oh, it got still. Okay. So that might have been a change. This morning it was windy, like at the top Chair 9. It was blowing pretty hard. But I guess the reason I mentioned that is that we're influenced more in the winter by the jet stream. That's why these values go up so high. So we can be prone to more wind. Maybe with the sort of change in between the storms is why the winds died off, which is actually in the afternoon can kind of be a rarity. But why is it windy? It has to do with the jet stream, but also the winds are the key in bringing in our precipitation. And we get mainly what's known as orographic precipitation anywhere in Colorado in the winter, meaning the jet stream itself usually sits up at 30,000 feet, like really high up. But during this time of year, the atmosphere gets compressed, and I'll show a couple diagrams doing this, but it gets compressed, so the jet stream influence touches the tops of our mountains. Our mountains also act as nets to catch moisture, and this is just known as orographic effect. This is the main reason why Denver, for the most part, is like a desert, right? It's pretty dry down there. We've had a lot of storms here. Most of the precip, depending on where it's coming from, has not hit Denver. Yeah, they've gotten a few snowstorms, but nothing compared to what we get. So determining how much snow we get and how we get it will be influenced by the prevailing winds and the orographic effect, meaning the windward side of the mountains will catch the moisture mainly in precipitation form, rain and snow, and then rain shadow effect happens on the leeward side. Just have the ocean in there as a general reference, right? That'd be the Pacific Ocean for us in North America. So this is how our stuff sets up. Now, what does this mean in terms of systems and storms? Prevailing wind direction will favor certain ski resorts. And that is sort of why if a particular pattern prevails most of the winter, meaning let's say we get mainly storms from the northwest. Most of our northwest flow comes November to March. It doesn't mean you can't get northwest flow all year long, but most of the year northwest flow comes during November through March, and that's what brings these storms from the northwest. These storms will favor Vail, Steamboat, Telluride, things like that. The rain shadow effect then, right, the snow hits these mountain fronts and the snowfall totals will typically be less on resorts further to the south and east on the other sides of this. Doesn't mean that those ski areas can't get snow, but you might get, let's say, a 10-inch storm in Vail, an 8-inch storm in Breckenridge, for example. Then we also get westerlies. Westerlies also occur during the winter, right? Like right now, in fact, is a westerly and also even more of a southwesterly with some of the flow that we're getting from this recent storm now. And again, this will favor like Beaver Creek, Aspen snowmass coming directly from the west. Durango and Wolf Creek get it directly from the west. There's gonna be more relationships with El Nino too. And I'll get into those too as we move through the presentation. And early in the fall, we had another phenomenon called upslope that comes. And that's why right now Loveland actually has the most snow of any place in Colorado, of like 140 inches or something for this time of year, which is just a phenomenal amount of snow. And that's what we call a southwesterly flow or storm or an upslope condition. So, you did give me this board, didn't you? Mm-hmm. So I can use this a little bit. So just two general rules. Like the first thing is we have centers of low pressure. Low pressure means wet conditions and high pressure means dry. So it kind of rhymes. High means dry, low means wet. Low holds all the storms that have snow and moisture in them for the most part. You're going to get a rotation that occurs around a low pressure. It's known as counterclockwise flow around the system. So this system's going to move across. So if I use this as a guideline, even if it's a westerly system, it's a low pressure, it's coming across or coming sort of from the southwest, and the spin around this low pressure is going to spin basically air currents, moisture, and stuff into the front range, meaning that's why you get what's called an upslope phenomenon. So if this spin with the arrows I'm drawing would spin the moisture back in and hit the mountains with snowfall, and that's going to bank itself up against the Continental Divide. And so that's what we had most of our low pressure system set up as. Wasn't as strong as being a frontal precipitation, but it was more of a low pressure that came across and then it spun the moisture into all of our front range ski areas. So Winter Park, Keystone, Breck have tons of snow, and Loveland for the most part. Also, this favors, Wolf Creek gets favored by a lot of stuff. If you ever go down there, most of the year they get hit hard because they can get all these. We all get them, but for some reason they're just in the right spot where they're influenced by a southwest flow, they're influenced by westerlies. Northwest is not as much, but these two things that occur most of the year, they just get hammered by snow. So these typically can happen more often in March and May and in like October, November. So it's mainly a front end and back end type of phenomenon where you get upslope. Doesn't mean you can't get these all winter, but those are the times that it happens more often. And when you see that, then that's what it's going to favor. So the southwesterly is also sort of tied to what we call upslope, which I mentioned there. So any questions about general wind direction and why it happens? And it's just determined, it gets determined by the time of year of how it gets set up and stuff. So seasons then play into this. So obviously now we're getting into shorter days, December, January, February, and into March. And this is why we love Colorado, cold and snowy champagne powder. It was like that this morning. And then, like I said, going back to the wind idea, wind is a major factor, and the wind happens because of the jet stream. So here's your graphic that I mentioned. The jet stream itself, winter, the troposphere is the atmosphere we live in. It pushes the jet stream up through thermal expansion when it's summer because of warmer temperatures expand our atmosphere. The jet stream rides higher. November, December, January, February, the jet stream starts to come down because our atmosphere gets compressed by cold air. And that allows the jet stream to sit down and almost touch the tops of our mountains. So sort of a little bit of a spinoff of the 200 mile per hour jet stream winds is that they can reach down to 13, 14,000 feet and we're getting 70 to 100 mile per hour winds higher up. And maybe 40, 50 mile an hour gusts at the top of Vail Mountain at 11,000 feet. And so we'll see this most of the winter. It might die off in between a cold front, you know, or a storm phenomenon system that happens. So this is what we're seeing here. That leads to wind loading now on certain slopes, right? So if you've got a prevailing wind direction, blows all the snow into one area, the snow can get loaded up. Then of course you have to avoid things like cornices and leeward slopes where the snow can get loaded up. This is just sort of my general plug, is that I'm gonna talk some about the avalanche conditions here in Colorado, but the best way to learn them firsthand is to sign up for like an avalanche level one course. Colorado Mountain College offers them. There's a few other services in the valley that do. You go out there in the backcountry and you learn, for example, digging pits to assess the snow layers. And that'll tell you about like what slopes to ski. I'm gonna show a video, a couple different videos that talk about this in detail a little bit too. But stat-wise, avalanches, you know, and why this is important is that Colorado is still the leading state for avalanche fatalities overall. And this is a graphic sort of showing the, over the years, because of increased backcountry use. This one is, shows that our fatalities have sort of leveled out. There's really not a significant change in the last 20 years. Some years we get maybe one death, other years we get 12, you know, so it's sort of in that realm. But overall, Colorado has the most. This is a avalanche fatalities by year where you combine all the states in the US, and it is increasing, but I would also attest this to the fact that we've increased populations in the Western US. We've got more people that like to get out and enjoy the sport, whether, and it doesn't matter if it's skiing or, you know, other means of human transport in the backcountry, but more people are getting out and enjoying the outdoors, which is great. But it's definitely something to be aware of. This graphic, though, is what sticks out to me. And like I said, is that Colorado is leading. You know, Alaska's high, too. But Alaska's a huge state. But we're by far and away much higher than all these other ones. Of course, Washington, Utah, Montana, these would make sense as to why their numbers are reasonable in the moderate levels. And then these states, of course, not a problem comparatively. But it's something to be aware of to get educated in this. And now also, regardless of the numbers, we're getting into the months that are dangerous, right? So December, January, February, March, and April have all the fatalities for the most part. And where are we? We're right smack dab in December now. So the next 2 or 3 months are the critical times. So there are 4 factors of avalanche avoidance. And this is where turning to members at your table, take about a minute or two. You've got a sheet of paper that was set on your table, and I would like you to converse with your members and try to come up with your own 4 factors of avoiding an avalanche. I know this is very open-ended, but take about maybe 2 minutes and see if you can come up with a list, and then I'll share with you what these are and we'll talk about them too.
Let's do it, man.
We
didn't have a care in the world as we skied from Univa Peak down the powder-filled backcountry slopes of Vail Pass, and we'd make another run before calling it a day. In the distance, on the steeper slopes, we could see a couple small avalanches. But today was all about avoiding avalanches, and it all started in the parking lot.
So by putting on the surge, I'm right on him now.
That's right.
I walk away.
And it gets weaker.
Yeah, so it gets weaker, see?
I see some people that take their transceiver and they put it on. Yeah, sometimes they leave it in the pack, then they check up higher. And that's not a good practice because what if you don't have batteries in there?
Dr. J.C. Norling teaches avalanche safety courses. And as I skied away from the parking lot with him and Dr. Jon Kedrowski, I played it all out in my mind. If one of us got caught in an avalanche, what would I do and in what order? It's the kind of mental checklist I have on most of my mountain climbs as well.
Once we get some more storms, and now we have layers on top of this. This will be a persistent weak layer.
JC is referring to what's known as surface hoar, a brittle kind of snow that acts like ball bearings under pressure.
The sweet spot for avalanches is 38 degrees. But once you go over 30 degrees, you're kind of in that spot where you could trigger something.
Think of the snowpack like a game of Jenga. If a layer of snow underneath is bad, then the whole thing crashes down.
To see the layers in here.
But to see those bad layers requires digging a test pit higher on the mountain.
So you can see we've got a little slab.
Oh yeah, look at that. That's what held.
Yeah, so just doing a tap test lets you know you got a little bit of a slab.
The tilt test that JC just did helps you visualize how the snowpack might behave.
This is just rotten snow right now.
And there's also the tap test.
10 taps in the roof. Whoop.
Six.
So that was a CT6. And it went on that depth pour layer. For me, on something like that, I don't want to ski this over here right now.
Right.
You know other people did.
Because look at that.
Armed with that knowledge, we knew exactly where not to ski.
Beautiful up here, heading towards the top of Vail Pass. And man, here goes Jon and JC. Just skinning up the track here. Look at that sun, look at those powder tracks.
We eventually top out with beautiful views in all directions. And without a care in the world, we drop into the powder, knowing that it all started in the parking lot.
And, all right, so let's go to your guys' list. And let me open this back up. So the first thing that's on my list was, I went ahead and I called up JC because he teaches avalanche courses over there, right? So I went with somebody that's more experienced than me, right? That had more knowledge, and maybe I could learn something from him by going up there. Does anybody have that on their list at all? Yeah, a little bit. Does anyone want to share maybe number two, what they might have had? This is number one for me, four factors of avalanche avoidance. Anybody want to share one of theirs? Any volunteers? Someone's, Mr. in the back, yes, sir. Yeah, that was good. And JC said that in the video, right? Bam, look at that. Excellent. So that was number two is, yeah, he sort of said the sweet spot. It's the 30-degree rule is what we call it. Generally about 30 to 38 is kind of the hot zone because snow can sort of stack up that level of steepness, those degree of steepness. The snow can stack up, it can bind together, but it can also then, you know, if you have that depth hoar layer, that's H-O-A-R, and that gets what's called facets, that can be really weak in the bottom, and if you get lots of snow over that, then that's where a trigger, meaning a skier, could trigger that, and then it would slide. Anything steeper than 39 or 40 degrees will probably have slid already, and anything less steep, well, that's why we went up on that flatter terrain higher up above treeline was because that was like 25 degrees and it was beautiful views and safer. So that was kind of the reason why we went and skied that other area. So, and then for me personally, I have a no steeps in January rule, sort of a loose rule that like, all right, I'm not gonna go climb a steep couloir. I'm not gonna go in that 30 to 38 degree range in January regardless. And then that just takes the risk completely out of the equation. And stuff. So that's definitely the most important is what they say in an avalanche course is terrain selection. Did anybody have this one? Don't go alone. Don't go out there by yourself. Again, I say alone is okay with certain rules, right? So I say, well, absolutely not. I'm going to go to an area that I've been to a million times that maybe already has a good skin track, and then I know there's several slopes, even up on Vail Pass. I know there's two or three little zones that, without a doubt, it's a lot safer. And I have cell phone coverage, and I'm up there. I might even, obviously, I'm always wearing my avalanche beacon. That's another sort of good rule. But wearing an avalanche beacon doesn't mean that you're going to avoid an avalanche. That's just somebody can dig you out, right, if something happens. But you should never have to use that beacon in the real, you know, the real sense, meaning like getting buried, you know. So yeah, I use certain discretion with the alone rule, and that comes with experience, right? If you go out there, we all live here in the valley, so you may have hiking trails you've been on, and you go out there on your own, you know the area, and you can use your own discretion. And there's something to be said for self-sufficiency and solitude in the backcountry too. Anyone else want to share what they might think is number four or another idea that you came up with your group?
Stay home.
Yeah, that's probably the easiest way, right? But I also say, even if the weather's really bad, so this goes back to my rule from the beginning of starting early, because you don't have to rush. You won't make a mistake. You won't make a hasty decision. If you've got all day to, let's say, get to a hut somewhere by nightfall and you started at 8 a.m., you're not going to cut corners. You're not going to go across a slope that could be dangerous to take a shortcut, or you're not going to make a decision that you wouldn't normally make because you're rushing. And then if something does happen and you were out there early, then you have all day to allow rescue to take place, or self-rescue, or if you have a teammate, let's say you started at 8 a.m. and you're going somewhere and your teammate hits a stump and they fracture a tibia or something and you've got to get them out. And if this happens at 10 a.m. and you've got a long way to get out, you will be able to get out during the day, versus if, let's say, you start at noon or 1 in the afternoon and you're out there and trying to do something that should take the whole day, well, then you've lost that time already. So starting early prevents a lot of, often one mistake compounds to another mistake, compounds to another mistake, and that's just all based on time. You can never get time back. So those were the four. And like I mentioned before, terrain selection is critical. And this quick little video is also a good highlight to this.
This is Bruce Tremper with the Forest Service Utah Avalanche Center, and today we're going to talk about how to read avalanche terrain. When you're heading uphill, often you come to critical decision spots. So believe it or not, this itself is a critical decision spot. I can either go up this spur ridge in front of me or go up the gully. So which way do I go? I always go on the spur ridges and not in the gully. The reason why is because gullies are a terrain trap. Even small avalanches can bury you deeply in the bottom of a gully. Whereas on a ridge, if you do trigger an avalanche, the avalanche tends to spread out and leave you high and dry. So it's easier to survive an avalanche you may trigger on a ridge than in a gully. Here we're looking at a slope where they triggered an avalanche about a foot or a foot and a half deep. And if it was on a different slope that had a nice gentle run out, especially with an avalanche airbag, you have a much better chance of surviving the avalanche. But this slope, on the other hand, goes into a narrow terrain trap. Now, even an avalanche airbag is not going to work very well on a slope like this. When you're choosing avalanche terrain, by far the most important thing is slope steepness. The avalanche activity, according to slope steepness, bullseyes right around 39 degrees, plus or minus about 5 degrees. So from about 34 to 45 degrees is where almost all avalanche activity occurs. So if you're going to go onto slopes of that steepness, you better be sure you have very, very stable snow conditions. A really important factor of terrain is the direction the slope faces, which we call aspect. For instance, that slope over there that's lit up in the sun is a south-facing slope because it's faced obviously towards the sun here at almost the winter solstice. On the other hand, the slope across the way in the shadows is a north-facing slope. A really handy way to know which slopes are dangerous and which slopes are safe are go to the Utah Avalanche Center website. On our avalanche advisor, we have what we call a danger rose. So we plot the avalanche danger by aspect and elevation.
The Colorado Avalanche Information Center also has the roses. And this is related to slope aspect and even like you know, this time of year, most of our sun is hitting these south and southwest facing slopes. So it's going to be freeze-thaw. It's going to consolidate it differently than it is in the spring. In the spring, it might thaw it out so much that the slope might be more dangerous, versus the north and northeast slopes aren't getting any sun, so they're not consolidating right now. So that depth hoar layer would be a problem, basically. You get into warmer months, March, April, May, June, when it consolidates all around, then the danger sort of drops on all those different aspects, but it will change seasonally. So it's just something to consider right there.
The center of the rose is the top part of the mountain, the high elevation. The outside of the rose is the bottom of the mountain, the low elevation. So it's kind of like looking down on a cone-shaped mountain, if that makes sense. And then we plot on there the north, south, east, and west. So you can, at a glance, just instantly see where the dangerous slopes are and where the safe slopes are. For instance, in the middle of the winter, the dangerous slopes are usually on the north to the east-facing slopes. And in the spring, the dangerous slopes are usually on the south-facing slopes. So remember, this is just a short video tutorial. If you really want to know how to read the terrain and travel through the terrain, be sure to take a field-based avalanche course. And if you want to know more about the gear involved, for instance, rescue gear or backcountry travel gear, then talk to the gearheads at backcountry.com.
Terrain selection being critical. And,
I have a question about that.
Yeah.
Seriously, when you're up on a hill, how can you look at a hill and decide if it's a 25-degree slope or 30? That's a pretty tiny difference.
Yeah.
And it can change. You know, you go, sure, you can go 100 yards at 25, then it becomes 27, then it's 30, then it's 32.
So that comes into, you know, going to the area multiple times, reading topographic maps to pick your entire ski line and really assessing it, the kind of the entire picture. Yeah, no, that's a good question. And then it's going to change. Aspect can change. So it's more about even poring over the maps before you go, you know, figuring out exactly where you're going to skin up to. We tend to go skin up to create our sort of zone where we know in between the two skin lines, if we're zigzagging, then we know, okay, this area is good. And there's some different tools as well that you can carry out in the field that you can stand and you can look at the slope from the side and you can get a fairly good reading on it too. Yeah. And now hill shades on some of these maps. So like I use a geographic information system map combined with the topographic map, and you can get hill shades that will shade the degree slope on the topographic map. Then you take it out there and then you have your shade so you know exactly where you can go. Yeah. So there's a lot that goes into it now. And it's a lot of fun, actually, trying to put it together to be safe in the right way. And then another general rule with snowfall and avalanches, if it snows more than 6 inches, then, and we do this a lot on our climbing expeditions, let the snow settle for 24 to 48 hours. That's going to already minimize avalanche danger, but then there's going to be a general danger, too, associated with it. But that being said, most snow does slide within 24 to 48 hours, at least sort of the naturally caused avalanches from either vibrations or sun that hits it, things like that. Snow will typically come down and then it'll also settle and get time to consolidate if it's gonna consolidate. So a good rule of thumb is to not just go out, oh wow, I'm at this hut and it snowed 2 feet last night, I'm gonna go ski that slope, yes. It's like, no, we're gonna just take a day and relax in the hut and then we'll go out the next day. So that's another good rule of thumb. When it comes to this stuff. So any questions thus far? Some great discussion points and everything with this. Understanding our snowpack too. There's a continental snowpack that we get in Colorado and that's drier. And then there's a maritime snowpack that you get more along the west coast of the United States. Anytime you have ocean influences, you're gonna get wetter atmosphere and you're gonna get wetter snow. So that's gonna influence how our snowpack sets up. And typically we do get that really bad depth hoar layer, which also is called monsters in the basement, because that depth hoar layer can persist for 3 or 4 months through the winter. And that can cause really bad avalanches even in March and April before it gets a chance to consolidate with warmer temperatures. So yeah, continental snowpack, these are all just characteristics of our snowpack in Colorado. We do have more bitter cold winters, relatively far from the ocean. We have drier snow. And we have that notorious depth hoar layer, which you saw some of the facets that we showed in that video. We get a moderate depth snowpack layer of 3 to 9 feet. So that's another thing to consider versus a maritime snowpack like in Washington and Oregon. They'll have 12 to 15, 18 foot depth. and big tree wells. If you've ever skied out in California or Washington or Oregon, you got to avoid the tree wells. You could fall down in there. And we don't get as many. Yeah, we get some tree wells, but not quite as, you know, large as the ones on the West Coast. And then we get periods of dry warmth in the winter, but the layers don't really consolidate sometimes until even May. You know, that Sheep Creek avalanche about 3 years ago that five people died in near Loveland Pass, that was in April, late April, and that was on a slope that had a big slab from the wind that blew all winter long, and the reason that broke off so catastrophically was that the depth hoar layer was about this deep of sugar snow, and it had about a 10-foot layer of good consolidated snow over the top, but it never binded to the bottom layer. Vibration set it off, and then it just all came down in a big slab with a huge fracture line. So those are always slabs. Persistent weak slabs are always big issues because of wind loading in the wintertime here. And then I just wanted to mention, you know, I showed the video from Vail Pass, but that video was shot in mid-January. We're up there. You go up there now, and it's already like 2-3 feet deeper than it was in that particular snow year. So there's no rule that says, you know, we're getting what we're getting now this year, and next year could be dry again, or vice versa. So going out, even in sort of changing conditions, bad weather conditions, you can learn a lot. You can always pull the plug, but if you stay conservative, you can go out and dig a snow pit. You can learn about it, you know, and every time I go out, I feel like I'm learning more and more about the conditions in these different areas. So that's something to consider. All right, so I'll move into a little bit with temperature and then talk about El Nino too in relationship to snow and what's happening as well. So temperature occurs, obviously, we know we live here, you know, in Colorado, and as we go up in elevation, usually temperatures decrease. Unless you drove down to Gypsum or Eagle this morning and the air was really cold down there, because cold air sinks. And so you get what's called inversion. Cold air is more dense, so it funnels down into the valleys, and it can be -5 in Gypsum and 10 degrees up here because of that inversion. But generally speaking, if you leave here in the morning, Walkie Mountain Science Center at 8 a.m. and you drive up Vail Pass, it's probably going to be 10 to 20 degrees colder up there, depending on the day. This phenomenon is known as adiabatic lapse rate, and it's a vertical distribution of temperature. Generally speaking, temperatures decrease as we go up. What will happen, though, is moisture content is going to impact that. So a day like today where we had a little bit of moisture in the air, not quite as dry, water holds heat. So water holds heat, meaning as you go up in the atmosphere, temperatures will not drop off the table quite as fast in those situations. If it does clear up tonight, it's going to get really clear and really cold and really dry, so drier atmosphere will mean that it will drop much faster. So on a clear night with stars in the air, you're going to typically get a 10 Celsius drop per 1,000 meters, which translates to about 5.5 degrees Fahrenheit per 1,000 feet of elevation gain. On a wet night or a cloudy night or a snowy night, and this is also why typically if it's snowing, it's maybe in the 20s and not in the teens or the single digits. And then when it clears out, yeah, like yesterday morning was frigid. So we're going to get more of a 3.2 degrees Fahrenheit per every 1,000 feet drop in a wet atmosphere. And our average global drop is 3.6. And that's just because we have water in the atmosphere, no matter where we are. You know, so unless you're in the Atacama Desert or down the Mojave Desert or down by Grand Junction, you're going to see closer to 3 or 4 degrees Fahrenheit per 1,000 feet, unless it's a totally clear day. Then you're going to go towards the dry rate. So that being said, yeah, most people will just take a five for every 1,000 feet and use that as sort of a calculation. But if I were to tell you that it's a, depending on the situation, I was just up on Denali climbing and skiing this past summer. And also, as you get higher in the atmosphere dries out. So above 10, 12, 14,000 feet, you're looking more at 5 degrees or 5.5. No matter what, unless it's a cloudy day. This was above the clouds on the summit of Denali. Dropping in and skiing this right off the top was a lot of fun this past summer. Believe it or not, I'll let you guys guess when this was, what the date was. This is at 20,000 feet, fresh powder.
Oh,
Anyone want to come with me next summer?
Yes.
So what was the date of that video?
4th of July.
It's close. It was June 27th.
Wow.
Yeah, we got really lucky. No wind. I actually didn't. I've summited a Denali 3 times, and this was the first time I didn't pull the down jacket out of the bag. Sun was out. Sun goes around the sky like this that time of year. So this was 3:30 in the afternoon. It looks like it's about noon or 10 a.m. So yeah, we're fortunate with the conditions up there. But if we use this calculation for lapse rate, and this is an example, if we use the 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, and I'm down on the Kelhitna Glacier at 8,000 feet, you know, and that last photo was right up there on the summit. You know, these are the temperatures. If you drop 3.6 degrees for every 1,000 feet of elevation, this will allow me to know what to pack. And if I wake up one morning, it's a crisp zero down on the glacier, and I'm going to try to go to the summit in a day or two, it's minus 42 up there. Whew, it is the coldest mountain on Earth, pretty much. Some of the coldest temperatures I've ever had. This past summer, we did get lucky, though. The weather wasn't so bad, relatively speaking, with temperature. It was maybe 20 below that on that summit photo. But with the sun out, just like you know here, you go skiing, it feels okay. It's not so bad.
Did you take a helicopter or did you skin?
No, we skinned up and climbed up. We pull a sled. What we do is, these are camps. So this is a camp down here. There's also another one up in here. We come around this peak to a place called Windy Corner. And at 14, there's a camp. We pull our sleds all the way up to this. A couple of the slopes are about 40 degrees, but most of them are 20 to 30. You're slowly going up. So we pull a sled with food, gear, tents, everything we need to survive up there. And so then there's a high camp that's put in, and then the summit. Summit day, we skied down down a face that got us to this camp. And then this is a gully called the Rescue Gully that we skied to get back to the camp. And then out down to the plain in 4 hours. So, which was really amazing. You can ski down all this and you spend a week trying to get up to the summit. So it's quite a journey. So here's your quick lapse rate question. And I'm, instead of it being a perfect bluebird day, because that would be too easy to do this calculation. You're just going to use 5 degrees and I don't want you to do that. Pretend that it's snowing and it's a blizzard. And you wake up in the morning in Vail Village. You're on a vacation to Vail, although most of y'all live here. But you're at the Sebastian and you wake up and you look out the window, and at 7 a.m. you ski, and 10 degrees is forecasted as the high for town. And it's snowing hard, though. And it's going to be like, just remember on Saturday how it was just amazing up there and you couldn't see anything? So it's going to be like that all day. It's not going to be like this. But the skiing will be like this. It'll be nice and powdery. So the question is, if the forecasted high is 10 degrees for town, what is the temperature on top of the ski mountain up at patrol headquarters at 11,500 feet? And remember, it's snowing. So with your group, do your lapse rate calculation real quick. Put that together. All right, any guesses? So we had 1 degree, you said?
Minus 2.
Minus 2? Okay. So again, I wake up in Vail Village to ski and it's 10 on the mountain. What's the temp at the top? I did it with the wet, remember you used wet adiabatic lapse rate because it's snowing, right? There's more moisture in the air. I'll show both calculations because there is going to be a difference, right? If you wake up in the morning and it's clear out, then it's not as wet of an atmosphere. You'd use the dry rate, meaning the temperatures would drop a lot more. So, 3,300 vertical, because that's going from 8,200 to 11,500. The difference in elevation is 3,300 vertical. And you have to divide that by 1,000 feet because our rate of change is like, you know, 3.6 degrees for every 1,000 feet. And so we do 3.3, the value calculated, times 3.6 Fahrenheit for every 1,000 feet of elevation gain. So you're going to be dropping by about 12 degrees. But the temperature was 10 degrees to start, forecasted in the village. So we know we have to drop by 12, so it's minus 2. Is that what you guys got? Okay, excellent. But now let's go back to the picture. We like these days, right? Where it's not snow. Well, we like both. But you love that bluebird morning where it's a lot colder. So when you use the dry rate, the dry rate you're going to use about 5 degrees or so. And so now it's going to be a little bit colder. It's going to be 16.5 degrees colder up on patrol headquarters by Buffalo's, which means you might have a few more breaks that day, maybe. If it's powder day, maybe not. It's hard to go in when those days are that good. So 10 minus 16.5, so it's minus 6.5 on the summit. So it's a little bit colder. So it's just something to consider. All right? So that's how you calculate the wet adiabatic lapse rate versus the dry adiabatic lapse rate. And now the season starts to change, which this seems like a long way off now, right? So I have all of December, January, February. But when the snow conditions start to settle, this is where I like to get out there. And this is the top of Mount of Holy Cross. This is Halo Ridge. And this is a really awesome couloir to ski. And March, April, May, and June, we get longer days. We do get some heavier snow, and we get that upslope snow storm condition I was talking about. And the layers will consolidate, and you can start skiing steeper snow conditions during this time. And it stabilizes. So you're going to get corn snow. You're going to get clearer days. And how much snow are we going to get all winter by the time the spring rolls around? Well, this could be dictated by El Nino. And I have the latest climate update. These were years where we had, and you know, it said that a La Nina is colder sea surface temperatures in the Pacific. In 97, we had an El Nino, which happens every several years with warmer sea surf temperatures off of the coast of South America, basically in the equatorial regions. The NOAA Climate Center just came out with a brand new report on El Nino for this season. And it's trending towards a little bit of El Nino happening, as long as I can get this to pull up. Maybe in the interest of time, I don't have to show the report. I don't know why it's not loading. I don't necessarily have to show it. Really what they were saying is that it's neutral. And so I'll go back in the presentation. What happens is when we say neutral, we have some inklings that there's about a 1 degree warmth change. This goes all the way up to 9 degrees, which is very significant. Right now, this area, all this report says, and I'll summarize it for you, is that we do have some warm pockets of water that are maybe 1 to 2 or 3 degrees warmer than normal. And so it's starting to trend towards El Nino. But until it shows about 5 to 9 degrees of warmer water at sea surface temperatures, they're going to still call it neutral, meaning it's not going to influence us just yet. If we do get an El Nino, what happens is we get these storm tracks from low pressure, right? So I talked about low pressure counterclockwise flow can come and slam into Colorado. It's going to pull, because it's counterclockwise, it's going to pull the moisture. And yeah, these southern areas get more rainfall typically, but that can mean that the moisture will get pulled up in Colorado. And if it does do that, we've had El Nino years where we get more snowfall. Another thing that happened was when you look at this, powder, Telluride. But when you look at this graphic, we had warmer water right in here too, and we have that happening right now. And at the end of the summer, October, we had like two tropical storms that pounded into Baja and into the Southwest, and then they end up hitting us, and that's why we got all that snow in October and early November. So we do have a lot of moisture. Anytime you have more moisture, yes, there is a chance that we get more precipitation based on that. So that's sort of a simple summary of El Nino, since we are sort of running out of time. So get out there, and I think a lot of you guys are getting out there already. Are there any questions? I know I've used a lot of time on this stuff tonight, and hopefully you've gotten a lot out of it.
Is there any, with the temperature rising in the oceans, is there any general trend with wind variation and the rise of ocean temperature?
Overall, yes, because if warmer sea surface temperatures occur across the board, that could lead to more water in the atmosphere, and then more water in the atmosphere would mean we get more less champagne powder and more, you know, snow that's got higher moisture content. And so that could lead to more snowfall. But yeah, there's not really a direct correlation with it, at least as of now, you know. It's sort of a, it's hard to predict. The best predictability is El Nino and La Nina, because if you have colder sea surface temperatures, then you're not going to have that moisture getting into the air as easily through evaporation and stuff. So, yeah, so that's kind of the simple answer. And we have seen in El Nino years that, especially southwest Colorado, the snowfall totals have been 20 to 30% higher in those seasons. And we are trending that way. They call it neutral now because the sea surface temperature is only about 1 or 2 degrees warmer than normal. They have to get a little higher, and it's trending that way. So they're still predicting with about 80% certainty that by January and February it will go into El Nino though. So yeah, so it probably will happen. All right, so we'll be skiing some of this. How much time do we have? Anyone want to hear about a little bit about Everest?
Yeah.
Running out of time? Okay. Otherwise, I was going to say we could do another show sometime. But anyway, I appreciate you coming, and I'm going to talk about Everest. And so this is a photo from the north side in Tibet, and I'd never been to Tibet before. So I was guiding a group of clients to base camp on Everest on the south side, which is in Nepal. I go there every year. And I got a call from a donor, a friend, and a couple other people that wanted to donate to help my youth foundation with some of the talks that I do, but also to fund me to climb Everest again. And I was like, really? And that was in Nepal during that time. So I called up another buddy of mine who had access to go to Tibet, and got a permit, and I was able to fly over to Lhasa and drive 3 days to get to Everest Base Camp, which is at 17,000 feet. So it's a totally different experience. Like when you're in Nepal, you trek for about a week or 10 days to get to base camp. And when you're in Tibet, you actually drive through different towns in the middle of the Tibetan plateau. And it's a totally different landscape too. And it's a really dry environment. This is actually also, and on both sides they use yaks to transport the gear to base camps. But on the north side, it's so much drier. And that's from the rain shadow effect. So all the fronts come from the south, and they affect this. And the reason we can climb Everest in the spring, no matter what side you're on, is because the wind and the monsoon. So the jet stream sits up there for 49 or 50 weeks out of the year. And this is sort of, you know, you can't go up there. It's 200 miles per hour. Next time you're in an airplane, look out the window. It's, you know, that's how high Everest is. And what happens with the monsoon is that in January, we have offshore flow from high pressure and cold air, and it switches. By June and July, you get monsoonal flow flowing from south to north. And basically what occurs is the jet stream that's sitting over Everest all year long, it gets pushed by the oncoming monsoon that does start by June, but it starts to get pushed in May. And in May, for about 2 weeks, the jet stream gets pushed away to where some days are dead calm up there. 2012, when I summited on May 26th, dead calm. Calm as it is in this room, I got really lucky. I knew that that calm day does exist every year for maybe 1 or 2 days. If you're gonna try to climb without supplemental oxygen, you have to go on that day. So the goal is to go there, acclimatize, try to climb up and down the mountain and establish camps and climb without oxygen, but to try to find that perfect day. And if I was going to be climbing up on a day that wasn't quite perfect and everything wasn't right and there's some other factors I'll discuss, then I would turn around no matter what. That was my rule. Because there's so many things that can go wrong if you have too much wind, you don't have the right weather, and things like that. So it's all about finding the perfect day is the goal. And the north side is very different because this is a little bit older depiction, but we've got what's known as the Rongbuk Glacier. And this goes up to an advanced base camp at 21,000 feet. This is the same height as Camp 2 in the Western Kum on the south side of Everest. So the difference is it's so dry that there's no crevasses and there's no ice fall. Like the famous Khumbu ice fall where the climbers go through on the ladders does not exist on the north side of the mountain. The difference is there's a few technical steps on the north side that make it a little bit more challenging at high altitude. But we can take yaks all the way into the same height above the Khumbu ice fall on the north side than the south side. So that was kind of appealing to me. From base camp, which is further down the valley, it's a 12 mile, 12 and a half mile, almost a half marathon hike to get to this camp. So you had to hike up and down that. But it was just a glacier that was a moraine, a glacial moraine that you hike with these yaks. So it was a little bit different. This was my goal and the reason why I went back. Is I wanted to learn more about it. Like, is it really possible? Like, you hear stories of like Reinhold Messner and several other famous climbers, Conrad Anker, Melissa Arnott. There's several climbers that have been able to summit without oxygen. And they were able to do it based on good weather, acclimatization, and physiology too. Some people just don't have the physiology. Growing up here in Colorado, and even I have climbed a couple of other high peaks without oxygen, it's been a progression for me to learn if and I felt like, you know, maybe it's possible, but I want to experiment with it and see. So I went there to try to see if that's possible. These are some of the keys that you have to think about. So for me, the number one thing was to learn about it being that you have to have the perfect weather day. But we get to base camp on April 20th. We drive to base camp in Tibet. It's crazy. You get in a truck and they just drop you off. And I had acclimated already by going to base camp on the south side with clients. So I'd already touched 18,000 feet and had been up there for a while. And then I came back to Kathmandu. Then I flew to Lhasa. So I had pre-acclimatization. That's the only way you can actually drive there. When we were driving there, that being said, we stopped in about four different cities on the way because you get up higher and higher very slowly. But then when you get to base camp, you have to still sit there for about 5 days. I was kind of pre-acclimated, so that was good. So the goal is to touch at least 8,000 meters one time before you go to the summit. Don't linger at altitude anytime you're above 7,500 meters, which is pretty high. You go up there, you don't spend the night, you just touch it, you come back down. This is base camp on the north side. So there is a highway that gets to about a mile from here and then it turns into a dirt road. These are all the pods. You hear, you know, it looks a little bit like, yeah, there's a lot of people here, but the other appeal to going to the north side was that they only issued 150 permits. On the south side, they issue 500. So when you're here, it doesn't feel very crowded, and it's a little bit cheaper, too, to go and do it on this side. My expedition was about 18,000, and I had it all sponsored. The south side, there's a lot more cost associated with it and stuff, so it's a little bit cheaper to do it on this side and stuff. And I went with a friend of mine who I've done three other expeditions with before. And so this is actually a glacier. This is the Rongbuk Glacier. If you dig underneath that, there's ice in there. But it ends, and then this is just a big glacial outwash plain, and it felt like Mars. And of course, you see Everest in the distance, about 15 miles away. So this is a river. So it's crazy. It's so dry, but it's also really cold in April there. So this is all ice coming from a river that flowed down one of the side valleys. And you're out on the Tibetan Plateau. This is 17,000 feet. And this gives you a better idea of that glacier, but very much ablated. Here's a picture of the south side on Everest by comparison. Still looks fairly dry, but this ice is much more prevalent here and stuff. So that's the south base camp. That's the north base camp. And again, we get dropped off. We have dining tents, cook tents, stuff like that. I'll run you through this real quick, and then I'll show some photos from up on the mountain. But if you're climbing on oxygen, what happens is you do two acclimatizations. You go to base camp, which you saw in the photos. We hike up to advanced base camp, which is a 13-mile hike. We stay there for two or three nights. We have active rest days. We have some short acclimatization hikes in the area to just get adjusted. And then we come back down and return for a 4 to 7 day recovery period. This is pretty standard. When you're climbing on oxygen, you do it again. So you go up twice. The second time you go up, you go to the North Col, which is above advanced base camp, and you touch the North Col, which is at 23,000 feet. It's the same height as Camp 3 on the Lhotse face on the south side of Everest. Once you're up in this camp, if you're on oxygen, maybe you try to touch a little bit higher. But nowadays, people just crank their oxygen higher. But on these two rounds, nobody goes on oxygen. They go up, they touch as high as they can, they come back to base camp, they recover. And by then, it's early May, and you wait for the weather to get good by like May 20th or so. And then what happens is people don't touch much higher because now they know they can go back up on oxygen, they crank their oxygen, they can summit. So that's sort of a different thing. Now, when I was not doing oxygen, and again, these are the yaks hiking up, it's just a totally different landscape with the glacier. It's so dry and different, which was really cool. This is along the route up to Advanced Base Camp. When I'm doing no oxygen, I had to do three rotations or four rotations. I had to touch much higher. But this was all part of the fun. It was all about going higher, but it was also, I got to climb two other peaks during this time that were sort of out of the way that hardly anybody has ever climbed before. We had a permit for a unnamed 6,200 meter mountain that we hiked in hiking boots because there was no snow. So it was really neat, just a really cool area. But we do these other, this extra push. So there's still like, you get done acclimatizing by like May 2nd, May 3rd. And most of the summits don't occur till like the 20th. So we still had like 2 or 3 weeks to hang out in base camp. Most climbers will hang out in base camp. They'll go to a lower village to recover. Myself and two other teammates were all trying to climb without oxygen. So we climbed some other mountains. We went out and did other stuff. And we still had plenty of recovery time every time we came back down. And so you just have to do a lot more. Our goal is to do our final rotation up high by May 13th, still allowing another week of rest before the summit push. So there's just a lot more that goes into it. And we did go up and touch the high camp at 8,000 meters during this climb. These were a shot from that other summit, which is about 50 feet higher than Denali. And there's other mountains in the area that were way higher. And this was after a fresh snowfall. So the Tibetan Plateau was just a beautiful place to visit. I was just amazed. I want to go back again and go visit other places in that area. This was another climb that we did outside of Advanced Base Camp. We hiked up this valley. And I actually didn't have my skis. There was fresh snow on these slopes up here, and I wish I had my skis. But we climbed Lac Parry, which is about 24,000 feet, right across from Everest. This is on the summit ridge. When you see Everest from this side, it doesn't look the same at all. You couldn't even tell this. I mean, this could be any mountain anywhere. Advanced Base Camp is here. The North Col is here. The North Ridge goes up. And so that gives you a sort of an example. But we got to climb Lac Parry, which has been climbed by less than 300 people in history. So that was really fun. And Advanced Base Camp at 21,000 feet. Again, the yaks come to here and bring all the extra food and gear that you need, and you just hike up and down. But recovery is key. So to recover fully, you had to hike 13 miles back to the original base camp at 17,000 feet. Even though it was 13 miles, you'd do it in about a 6-hour day. But getting down and recovering was very important. Here's another shot of Everest. This is the Hornbein Couloir right here. And the route goes up this ridge to the summit. A little rocky because they get so much wind. This is looking down from Advanced Base Camp to Base Camp, which is on the other side of the glacial moraine. But look at this landscape. It just looks like Mars. This glacier, you can see the striations along the side. It was about 1,000 feet thicker 150 years ago. So it's really receded with glacial climate change. We had some pretty cool dome tents where we could recover, play pool, and lounge around, play chess. They had a bar. The Russians had a bar. So this was like glorified car camping, right? So in base camp there, they can drive there. So they, when we got there, they brought a big truck with all this extra stuff to set up and stuff. Because it's like car camping. It really is. So that was what I love about the north side. Totally different. And then we've got yaks hanging out. They would carry stuff up. It cost $300 for a yak to go one way up. And we had 21 yaks take our gear to Advanced Base Camp. So do the math. That's the cost. But our team had eight, we had eight climbers and three of us were attempting without oxygen. This was also so showing Lac Parry. Some other climbers actually had some permits too to go climb it, but just sort of the night shots. This is the wall going up to the North Col at 24,000 feet up here. And then the route goes up the ridge. This is in the morning we would climb up. Advanced Base Camp is here. Lac Parry is the background. And then we climbed up this in about 3 hours to get to the North Col. We had about six Sherpas that we hired to help carry loads and to climb with our members and stuff. My friend Arnold, who runs this company, he's married to a Sherpa. His wife was the first Nepali woman to climb Everest and K2, both of those mountains. So he's married into this family, and so he brings all his brothers-in-laws on these expeditions. So we're putting together another one for next year. This is the North Col, and you climb up this ridge, and you go all the way up. The high, there's two more camps. So this is the 8,000 meter camp right in here, 7,900 meters, so 26,000 feet. The start of the death zone is right about here. Takes about 4 to 6 hours to walk up this ridge and then climb through the cliff bands. And then 8,300 meter camp is right here. So by contrast, on the south side of Everest, there is no camp this high. This is the highest camp in the world, 8,300 meters. When you're not on oxygen, you don't stay in that camp. You launch your summit attempt from this camp here. So that was a fundamental difference on this trip for me, was being able to start climbing up from lower. Just great views though, amazing views. So this is now climbing, this is Cholatzi, which was first summited in the 1960s. And this is the North Col. So now we're up on the ridgeline going up towards 8,000 meters. This is Choyu, the eighth highest mountain in the world over here, or sixth highest mountain in the world. And again, back in base camp, there's their perspective looking back up. Where that last photo was shot was like right here. So we still have a long way to go. So now I'll talk a little bit about the summit and what sort of things went played into the mindset of the summit attempt. In 2012, when I summited, there were only 4 good days that you could do it, that it wasn't bad weather or too windy and stuff. This past year, there were actually 11 days in a row. It was the biggest weather window in history. So that actually was good because so many climbers started summiting early and getting done and out of the way. And so by the time we went up on our attempt, it was just our small team. And there was one other Russian team of 5 people. So it wasn't crowded at all, which was really awesome. You could know you could sort of settle in and set up your timings and stuff. So choosing the weather window is key. As I'm showing these photos, basically what happens is you're resting in base camp, you spend 1 day, you hike the 13 miles, you get to advanced base camp, you take a rest day here. Then we had 5 members on oxygen. So during our rest day, they actually were up here a day before, myself and my friend Rasmus and Carol. And they went up the day before us, the team on oxygen, and they stayed in the North Col. We stayed here for a day. That night, they spent the night. In the morning at about 8 a.m., they left to start going up to this camp here. And this is the 7,900 meter camp. This is the high camp. We basically climbed up and met them when they were leaving. So we started at 3 a.m. And so this is all to minimize your time up high. When you're not on oxygen, you can't be up higher for very long. So instead of using a night here and deteriorating without oxygen, our climbers on oxygen would put oxygen on here and start hiking up to this camp. We started at 3 a.m., met them at breakfast, and climbed together as a team to be here with all 8 of our members and Sherpa support. We got here at about 1 p.m. When you're on oxygen, you stay on oxygen, you spend the night here. We had to get up and start at midnight and start climbing through the night, not stay at this camp, and keep going to try to summit by sunrise. But not really, if you're on oxygen, you summit at sunrise. If you're not on oxygen, you have to wait longer. And that was a debate between me and my teammates, actually, the ones that were climbing with me without oxygen. I argue, and I've heard from other people that have summited, that you have to start later in the night because you have to shorten the night. You need to be up near the first step when the sun rises, so the sun hits you, so you get warmer. Because when you're not climbing on oxygen, you get colder. When you're on oxygen, you stay warmer. It's just sort of a thing that happens. So you have to start later. We were in disagreement, me not wanting to climb alone. I agreed to leave earlier in the night with them, and I did. It still was sort of against what I wanted to do personally, because I knew Melissa Arnott, Adrian Bollinger, climbers that have made it without oxygen, they try to summit by 10 or 11 in the morning knowing that they do have the perfect day, meaning the weather's good, so they can be up there later. It's okay. There's no rush to get up there early. So we climbed through the night. It was a little bit slow. We actually took a break because we had an extra tent and we boiled water because we got here at about 11 p.m., which was too early, in my opinion. We boiled water. We tried to waste some time. At this moment, Carol decided that she wasn't going to try to do it without oxygen. She stayed in her tent with her Sherpa, and they brought more oxygen up for her, and she waited. Our team woke up the next morning at 8 a.m., and they climbed up, and they stayed another night here, and then Carol went the next day and summited with them. So we were all sort of in the same area, safety in numbers. Myself and Rasmus continued up with we together had a Sherpa that climbed with us. So as we went up, I still didn't feel right about it. It got really windy on the ridge. And as we were going up near the first step, he also was about 2 hours ahead of me. And we actually kind of lost track of each other in the night and then ended up me being all alone, right? So I'm up there, and this is a shot from the camp that we left at about 8 p.m. at 7,900 meters. And we get higher up here, and this is the ridgeline that you're climbing on in the night, basically. This is a photo that I took of the second step. So you get up to higher than the first step, it's still dark, and already in my mind, I'm like, okay, it's like 2 a.m. I should be here at 6 or 7 in the morning with the sun hitting me. I'm too early. I'm on the ridgeline. It's blowing 50 miles an hour. It's blowing sideways. Rasmus was up a little bit higher. I climbed up this ladder, didn't see him anywhere. And then when I got above the ladder, this is the view you see of the ridge. I don't know why this photo is doing this, but there were climbers, because there were climbers on oxygen that started from the higher camp, and they were already going up the summit at sunrise. It's about 3 a.m., 3:45, it's starting to get light already. It's blowing 50, 60 miles an hour. I already knew in my heart it wasn't the perfect day. This was a go or no call. I'm standing there. The longer you linger, you're gonna get cold. You're not on oxygen, you'd be susceptible to something bad happening. So in about 10 minutes, I made a decision. It was a tough decision, but I said, you know what? I'm gonna go down. When you know there can be a perfect day, there's just no reason to go up there. I had stood up on the summit in 2012, so that wasn't the issue. I was like, you know what, I've been up there already. It's okay, it's an easy decision. This was about a little bit higher up in the dark where I turned around. This is not my photo though, because it was dark, but this was just to give you an idea of the terrain in the area. This is a shot by Neil Beidelman, who was famous for the Into Thin Air incident, and he's from Aspen. His group was up there. They were up there the day, 2 days after summiting. And so this photo was about a little bit below this is where I turned around, but this gives you an idea of the terrain. And even from here, it's about another 2 to 3 hours to get to the summit. So when it's blowing that hard and you're not on oxygen, there were Sherpas turning around and they were on oxygen and they said it was too windy. It was easy call. I said, I'm gonna go down. So this is another photo from Conrad Anker's National Geographic expedition several years back. But this is below that last photo, about where I turned around in the darker and the waning light as it was starting. And so this just gives you an idea how high that is, you know. And it was an easy decision. I'm going down now, it's getting light. And I snapped this photo a little bit later, descending. And I got back to the high camp at 7:09 at about 7 a.m. though. So I got down pretty quickly. But that was another one of my rules. One of my teammates, Rasmus, stayed up higher with with the Sherpa, and lingered for a couple of hours, and it really deteriorated him. He was really, you know, coming down later in the day, it exhausts you. So you have to make a quick decision to go down. This was a shot looking down the North Ridge in 2012 on a perfect day. So I know the perfect day exists, and I also answered the question, is it possible to climb without supplemental oxygen? It absolutely is, but you have to have the right ingredients. So maybe someday I'll get to go back and give it a shot. But I learned a heck of a lot by doing this project. So, any questions? I had a lot of fun too.
So, why is the south side so much more popular than the north side?
Probably because it's Nepal, and the Nepalese government will approve unlimited amounts of permits. The Tibetan government is sort of wised up in terms of they charge a premium. They only allow a certain number of guided companies, like or expedition companies, I should say. Because our expedition wasn't guided. It's Arnold leads it, but he's sort of like, you know what, I'm not a guide. He's like, I'm an advisor. I help people make their decisions up there, and he's a good friend of mine. So then that's sort of the style I like to climb in and stuff too. But yeah, just different things going on with both of them and everything. So, but yeah, are there any other questions? I know I went kind of long tonight, but you guys have been a great audience, so thanks for having me, and thanks to Rocky Mountains, and I appreciate you guys coming.
Oh, the tents, how do they, are the, like the tents when you said,
are they Uber tents or are they just there for people to use?
There are tents. Like I carried my own tent up and set it up. And then as a team on load carrying, we would carry extra tents, come back down. The Sherpas, though, would help set them up too. You know, so you anchor them in the snow with stakes, and sometimes you use rocks, sometimes you use snow blocks, you stick ice axes. Yeah, no, you got to be creative. There's a lot of creative landscaping that takes place and everything. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So.
So I was curious about climbing at night. I'm assuming mm-hmm. you guys all have headlamps on.
Yeah, you climb in a headlamp, but also if the moon's out, you barely need a headlamp. It's so high up, the stars are pretty bright. Over the years, I've practiced like in different mountains here without a headlamp, because if it's too cold, the light goes out and you've got to manage without it. And that's happened to me before. So luckily in this case, my headlamp was good all night. But yeah, there's a lot of little intricacies that play into it for sure.
Not a lot of room for error.
Nope. And that's, you know, and that was another reason why, like I said, it was actually really easy to say, hey, you know what? And in my heart, I knew another reason we went up to try to attempt the summit on the 19th was, again, strength in numbers. I could have waited about 4 more days, but the rest of the team wanted to go get their summit done, and then I would have been up there all alone, too. I probably could have spent another $20,000 to have a personal Sherpa to go, but it wasn't in my budget. You know, that's another takeaway for me was, like, you know, in 2020, I think I have a good climbing partner that wants to go and join me on one, so then we'll climb together and do it. So that's another sort of factor that played into it, was sort of balancing having the perfect day, but then being up there all alone. If something goes wrong, there's no one there. So as a team, we're just being safer. And now I'm all about being safer. So.
Did the Sherpa still up always on oxygen? Or?
Everybody, unless it's a specific attempt without oxygen, everyone's on oxygen now. You know, and I agree with that because it's a safety thing. The only thing I partially don't agree with these days is that it could be a dangerous thing, is that some of the teams are doing what's called max oxygen. So they're having like 4 Sherpas carry all these bottles, and the clients are on like 4 to 6 liters a minute when they're breathing. And it's a lot. And they go through a lot of bottles, and it's like a drug. So if it does fail, like actually this year, Adrian Ballinger's team had about 15 oxygen regulators fail. Whoa. And they were up above, right about near where we were turning around with their team, and they all had to turn everybody around immediately, and a lot of people struggled and nobody died, luckily, but it can be a situation where it's bad. Like, I mean, you can pass out. Yeah, the body adjusts to it, and then if you take it away, you can pass out. And it was really unfortunate. They had to come back down, and luckily they sent about 6 of their members back up, but about 8 of their members had to quit and go home because they were too exhausted, they were too high, and they didn't have the right oxygen now, and they didn't have any left, and then they weren't able to go back up. So it ruined their summit bid because of the failure of the mechanical device. So that's another reason why in recent years I've been leaning more towards climbing without, because you don't have to worry about a mechanical device failing. You acclimatize properly, and you just embrace the process, and the chance to do it is there. So, yeah. But it was an amazing experience. And so, yeah, so a lot of people, I come home, and they're like, oh, you failed, you didn't summit, you didn't make it. And I'm like,
No.
I was above 8,000 meters twice, and I was 150 meters higher than K2 when I turned around. That doesn't feel like I failed, you know, and so it was a great experience. Learned a lot.
When you did it in 2012, did you do it without oxygen? Or
no, I climbed on a low flow rate that year because I had to carry my own bottles.
Yeah.
So that was another sort of factor, but yeah, it's just a progression.
How many women are in these groups?
This year we had 2 out of the 8.
Out of 8.
25%. It's more and more, yeah. I mean, a lot of these sports, it's awesome to see. Several of my really good friends are women. You get along with them better anyway on these trips. Mm-hmm. Like, honestly, they're less drama. Some of the guys get all into like the machismo, I got a summit, I got to do this, and the girls are more laid back and stuff. So
happy to be there.
Yeah, exactly.
Have to.
But excellent. Well, if you got a book, thank you very much. I'll sign it for you, and we've got some more for sale for Christmas holiday gifts. Again, there's my plug.
Awesome.